Hi, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn with me. Ephesians chapter 6. We're looking at the final passage there in Ephesians 6, verses 10 through 20, of which you're probably very familiar with, but we're entering into it. And it has not been a fantastic journey through the book of Ephesians this particular year of the way God has shaped us and formed us and spoken to us. And this passage is timely. It is timely for us because it speaks to us about who Jesus is and what he really truly wants to do in us and through us. And the way that we have to engage what is called spiritual warfare in this world. But do not miss. There's a clarity of vision here in this passage, a vision that calls us to him, calls us in surrender about God and his mission, because there's something powerful when the Lord is speaking and laying out a clarity of his vision. And we've tasted that in our own world. Last week, Rob Wilton, church planner, up here preaching. And I love church planners. I love his passion. I love just the clarity of mission that he was up here with. And meeting Rob for the first time, it's easy to see the God, what he's doing in and through him. And I took a trip up to Pittsburgh several months ago just to visit with him and visit with some other pastors and just kind of get a lay of the land about what he's up against there at Pittsburgh. And while on this particular trip, I was there with his dad. He mentioned last week about his dad, Don Wilton, pastor, First Baptist there in Spartanburg, who was Billy Graham's pastor. And Rob didn't really, he played it down last week, but when I got to meet Don Wilton, I was pretty excited about this because just prior to going on this trip to Pittsburgh, Billy Graham had passed away, and Don Wilton was the one who officiated all of the services there at the Capitol, there in Washington, there in North Carolina. And so I was curious about what does it feel like when you're on TV in front of 100 million people? You know, I was talking to him about all the details with it. So I was excited about talking with him. And just really unbeknownst to me, God gave me an opportunity to witness in on a moment at a dinner between a father and a son. And there was a dinner that we got to have, and there was a moment where the room finally got quiet, and Pastor Don just stands up and begins to place a blessing, begins to encourage, and begins to challenge his son, and used a phrase that I have never forgotten. And he looked at Rob, and he said, "Rob, since you were born, my prayer for you is that you will be a mighty warrior for the gospel." And I heard a father speak a blessing and an encouragement and a challenge upon his son. And it was like God was speaking to me in that moment. And this passage that we're going to take a look at this morning is our Heavenly Father speaking to us. I want you to hear your Father this morning speak a blessing over you, an encouragement over you, a challenge to you to be a mighty warrior for the gospel. Because this passage is about Jesus. This is not about us. Too many times we come to this passage and we make it self-centered and not Christ-centered. Jesus is the ultimate warrior. He is our victor. He is the champion. And he's calling us this morning to walk in his victory. To walk into his victory and to live a life that is centered in on him and his kingdom. So join with me this morning, Ephesians chapter 6, beginning in verse number 10. And in the honor of God's word, I'd ask that you stand this morning. Ephesians chapter 6, beginning in verse number 10. Highview, hear your Father speaking to you this morning. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand firm, stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert, with all perseverance, making supplication for the saints, and also for me, that words may be given to me in the opening of my mouth, boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. Pray with me this morning. Lord Jesus, Lord, we humbly come before you in your word to hear you, to follow you, to know you. Lord Jesus, may we walk with you in your strength and in your might. And Lord Jesus, proclaim your gospel boldly. Lord Jesus, please have your way with us this morning. Please remove all distractions and hindrances. And Lord Jesus, may we be changed this morning, filled with the Holy Spirit, and to be mighty warriors for the gospel. And we pray for this in the name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. I want to begin this morning with the end of the passage and not the beginning. I want you to hear Paul at the end of this passage clearly ask for the church, for his people, to do what? To pray, to persevere, to pray for boldness in the gospel. Come, take a look back with me. Take a look at the beginning of verse number 18. Praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert, high view, with all perseverance, high view, making supplication for all the saints, high view, and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. Too many times in this passage, we miss God's call for his mission and his kingdom. At the end of this passage, which speaks of God's victory and his armor to stand, there is a call, there is a declaration to go and to proclaim the gospel. What is Paul saying? Pray for me, persevere, stay alert, pray that the mystery of the gospel will be boldly proclaimed. What is the mystery he's talking about? He's talking about the revelation of God, that the gospel is for all people in all places at all times. It's not just for the nation of Israel. It is expanded out, and the gospel is now available to every man, woman, and child. If they surrender to the Lord Jesus, they can become, they will be a child of God. The gospel is breaking down barriers. It's going forth unhindered, and it is saving people left and right. And Paul, God has called him to go and proclaim the gospel to the Gentiles, proclaim it to us, that we can be saved, that we can know the forgiveness of sin, that the Lord Jesus has paid our price. And he's saying to them at that moment, I'm an ambassador, someone who's been given authority, someone who's been given a commission to go forth. But he says, I'm an ambassador, what? In chains. He is chained to a Roman soldier, but that does not change the mission. That does not change his role in the kingdom. And what is he praying for? What is he asking for? That he will proclaim it twice boldly. That he will not shrink back. He will not back down. That the armor of God is not for us just to be defensive and to form a fortress. The armor of God is for us so that the mission of God moves forth, that we engage in the war that is before us. Do you realize, Highview, we are at war. The Lord Jesus has called upon us to be his, to be his ambassadors and go to war, not in our own strength, but in his. It's his victory. He is our champion. He is the one who has come before us to do what? Be our redeemer, be our savior, to pay our price. And he calls upon us as his children to be his witnesses, firsthand account of his power, of his salvation, of his forgiveness. And we are called upon now to be proclaimers. The mission of God is always and ever before us. His kingdom is ever before us. We live not for ourselves, but for our King. So in the light of his mission, now let's come back to verse number 10 and let it unfold for us. Finally, this is the final charge in this book. Be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. Let's begin with that very first phrase. Be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. What's mind-blowing to me is that Scripture interprets Scripture, and that this is not the first time that the armor of God has been mentioned in Scripture. In Isaiah chapter 59, there is a clear, given, a prophetic call of a redeemer. Listen to this redeemer from Isaiah 59. He saw that there was no man. He was amazed that there was no one interceding. So his own arm brought salvation and his own righteousness supported him. He put on righteousness like a breastplate. Have you heard that phrase before? And a helmet of salvation on his head. Have you heard that phrase before? Here in this passage, he put on garments of vengeance for clothing, and he wrapped himself in zeal as a cloak. And it continues on in verse number 19. They will fear the name of the Lord in the west and his glory in the east. He will come like a rushing stream driven by the wind of the Lord. Listen to this. The Redeemer will come to Zion and to those in Jacob, that's Israel, who turn from transgression. Who is that Redeemer? Jesus. God himself has come, and he has come as a warrior with that breastplate of righteousness, that helmet of salvation. Make no mistake, we are following his lead and experiencing his presence. We do not walk in our own strength. We walk in his. He is the victor. He is the champion. He is the ultimate warrior. He has come and he has redeemed us. He has done for us what we could not do. He paid a price that we could not pay. He was perfect and he willingly laid down his life for you and me. He took upon our punishment, the wrath of God on our behalf. He took it on the cross. His body was broken. His blood was spilled for you and me, and yet demonstrated his power over sin and death after 3 days, doing what? Rising again from the dead. He is victorious. He stands in victory. And now he comes alongside of us and he says, walk with me. Walk in my strength. Walk in my victory. Be strong in the Lord. Don't be strong in your gifts, your ability, your strength. Be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. That's the first calling, is to himself, for his glory, for his power, for his strength, for his mission. And in the goodness and the graciousness of the Lord, not only does he strengthen us, but he gives us wisdom. He opens our eyes to some realities that we would not normally know about because he does not want us to walk in deception or ignorance. Take a look at verse number 11. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against what? The schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. We have an enemy. And that enemy, his name is Satan. And he began his appearance in the scriptures in Genesis chapter 3. He came deceiving, and he deceived Eve, led Adam into rebellion, and there sin entered into the world, and he has been at work ever since. And what is his goal? According to John 10:10, the goal of the enemy is to steal, is to kill, and destroy. And he will do whatever it takes to remove us from the presence of God and remove us from engaging in the mission of God. Now, C.S. Lewis writes in his great book called Screwtape Letters, he writes, there are two things the devil wants you to be engaged in. One is an unbelief in him, that he does not exist. And number two, he would love for you to become overly or morbidly obsessed with him and not God. The Lord is opening our eyes to greater things at work, the war that's really raging. He's opening our eyes to the spiritual warfare that's actually taking place so that we are not confused. We are not deceived. There's a clarity, but realize that our battle is not against flesh and blood, but the enemy does use flesh and blood. Do you remember Mark chapter 8? You remember when Jesus is revealing to his disciples for the very first time that he's going to die, that he's going to rise again, and Peter comes alongside of him, and Peter actually rebukes Jesus. Jesus, that's not the way it's going to go down. And Jesus turns around and looks at Peter and says, get behind me, Satan. Do you remember that moment? And he says, your mind is not set upon the things of God. Your mind is set upon the things of man, the enemy using even one of his own disciples to try to derail the mission of God. If you don't think that the Savior himself was tempted, don't you not think that we will be tempted? And the Lord is opening up our eyes to the spiritual warfare. Chuck Lewis, who's had extensive work on spiritual warfare, wrote an article about how the enemy specifically attacks us as the church. Number one, he writes, he, Satan, promotes what's called powerless Christianity. This is how the enemy distracts us. This is how the enemy gets us off task. He promotes what's called a powerless Christianity. We use the phrase here at Highview a lot, lukewarm Christianity, meaning that there is a moralness to you. There's an activity, a church activity to you, but you do not know, nor are you following Jesus. It's about activity. It's about being active and busy, but it's really not about pursuing our Lord and our Savior. There's not a relationship with him. Powerless Christianity is just simply activity and is not following the Lord Jesus. We are called to be in a relationship with him. We're not called upon to be lukewarm. We're not just to have Christian morals and values. We are called upon to be engaged in a real relationship where we are surrendered to him, where we are knowing Jesus in and through his word, and we are obediently following his lead. Number two is that he loves to weaken the family. Man, if he can destroy the family, he will destroy the church. If he can remove dad from leading, if he can create conflict within that marriage, if he can create conflict within that parenting, if he can destroy and use hypocrisy, if he can use unforgiveness and anger and whatever else he puts in that family, he tries to weaken and destroy the family. If he destroys your family, he will destroy the church. Why? Because the primary source of discipleship is the family. The primary source where God is designed for us to communicate him and to lead our children to him is the family. He weakens the family. I'm telling you, he weakens and destroys the church. Number three, he encourages hidden sin. Highview, we have experienced this. We know how devastating this is. We know that the enemy lies, tells us, you can't confess that. You can't let that be known. You can't do this, you can't do that. And he encourages us and somehow deceives us and think that we can manage sin, and somehow we can overcome it on our own, that it's not that big of a deal. It is. And the enemy, though, tries to deceive us and uses our pride and keeps us hidden. I'm telling you, it's destroying you. It's destroying our church. And the Lord wants to free you this morning. Number four, he promotes division in the church. Some of you, if you've been a part of church for very long, you've experienced this, right? Yeah, you know what I'm talking about. Where we become centered in our own stuff. We become man-centered. We become a self-promoter. And we take our eyes off of the Lord, and all of a sudden, division begins to take root in our hearts. And where does it begin? It begins in criticism. It begins by sitting back and being that Monday morning quarterback, right? And lofting all of your opinions. And somehow your opinions are more important than everyone around you. And all of a sudden the enemy begins to use that. And all of a sudden conflict comes into play. And guess what? The enemy is rejoicing when there is division in the church. When we are focusing on more of our own wants and desires and not surrender to the Lord Jesus himself. There's only one head of the church, and his name is Jesus. Number five, he infiltrates the church through false teaching. This happens to a lot of churches. It better not happen in Highview. I'm telling you right now, if a pastor steps up here and is not preaching from God's word, you better cast that dude out. You know what I'm saying? We are not messing around. We will not allow false teaching to enter into our community groups and enter into our churches. I'm telling you, the enemy has gotten a foothold in so many churches where they have been led astray by false teaching, where they are not adhering to the word of God. And he uses that false teaching to lead people astray and where they are destined for hell. And I'm telling you right now, we've got to be careful about teaching in our church. And number six is he persecutes the church. Now, in our Western world, this is hard for us to understand, but in other places of the world, I mean, he actually tries to make it illegal. He tries to squash that gathering together as the church, and he will do whatever it takes for that church not to be able to meet, and there is great persecution, even those who put their lives on the line in order to meet. These are six ways that the enemy uses to try to create confusion, to try to deceive, to try to lead away. This is the way that he attacks us. Now the Lord, out of his goodness and out of his grace, has said, he's greater. His strength is greater. His power is greater. We walk in his victory because our Lord has done what? He has come and he has defeated the enemy. He stands in victory. And now the armor of God is an invitation into his victory, into the power of his presence. Let's take a look at that. Beginning in verse number 14. Stand therefore, third time has been mentioned, having fastened on the belt of truth and having put on the breastplate of righteousness and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace in all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish the flaming darts of the evil one and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Now, what is Paul doing here? Paul is simply illustrating the presence and the power of the Lord Jesus, and he's illustrating it by making a basic observation of a Roman soldier. The Roman soldiers were the greatest at the time. They were armed to the hilt. They had the best of the best. And all Paul is doing is he's illustrating God's presence and his power through the armor of a Roman soldier. Now, let's not make too much of that. Let's not get too crazy in trying to illustrate everything and all of a sudden we get confused and we get sidetracked with a particular piece of armor. What you need to know is that armor was rare. Armor was expensive, and the Lord is overly providing for us. And what is he providing for us in his presence and his power? Number one, he's providing for us is truth. He is truth. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through him. In a land of confusion, in a land of multiple opinions, here comes eternal, absolute truth. And he gives it to us as his gift. And we can trust him. We can believe in him. We can build our life upon him. We can have convictions that really matter because he is the truth. And with that truth comes righteousness, that breastplate of righteousness, that righteousness that doesn't belong to us. It's not our right standing. It's his right standing that he bestows upon us. We are now stand before God, according to Romans, without condemnation. He has declared us as what? Righteous, not because of our goodness, but because of his goodness, because of the price he paid. He now bestows upon us his righteousness. We are standing right before the Lord because of his sacrifice and because of his grace, truth, and righteousness. Take a look at the next one. It's called the gospel of peace. Jesus is our peace. What did he say to his disciples? In this world, you will have what? Trials and tribulations. But in me you will have peace, for I have already overcome the world. He is our peace, and he's given us the message of peace with the gospel. He's called upon us to take it into a lost and dying world, into this very present darkness. We are called upon to walk into that darkness with the power of the gospel of peace, that people, you and myself, we can have peace with God. Because of Jesus, he has paid our price and he settled those accounts. Now we can have peace with him, peace for now and for eternity. And he calls upon us to walk into the world with the message of the gospel to further his kingdom. Truth, righteousness, peace. The next one is faith. He gives us this gift called faith to believe, to trust, because the enemy is throwing doubt and deception. He's throwing slander and accusations. And the Lord stands with us and for us and says, he or she, you are my child. Believe in me. Trust in me. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust him and he will act. That is Psalm 37:5. I've been memorizing that verse this week. It's the verse that the Lord has given to me. And I'm telling you, think about this. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in him and he will act. That's called faith. That's a life of faith. Commit your way to him. Surrender your way to him. Trust him. Believe in him. Surrender to him. Die to yourself. Live for him. And what's the promise? He will act. That's called faith. I mean, we're trusting in his actions. We're trusting in who he is. We're trusting in what he has done for us. That's called faith. And that faith, when the doubt comes and the enemy is throwing stuff at us, what do we remind him of? Jesus, the victory of Jesus. We remind him of the cross. We remind him of the empty tomb. We remind him that the one who's gone before us is victorious and we stand in his victory. Truth, righteousness, peace. Faith, salvation, the helmet of salvation, the assurance that our eternal destiny is secure. We walk into this battle. We walk into this war knowing that our price has been paid and we stand secure. We belong to him. Our eternal destiny has already been settled and we know that we're going to be spending eternity with the Lord. That helmet of salvation, which first belonged to him and he bestows it upon us. Now we walk in his victory, walk in salvation and the assurance of salvation that when we give our life to Christ, we are secure in him now and forever. And that leads us to the sword of the Spirit, the word of God, this beautiful weapon that the Lord has placed in our hands to be used for his kingdom and his mission. Do you know the power of his word? Do you love the weapon that the Lord has placed in our hands? Have you ever watched a little boy walk through the woods? I've got one, 8 years old. You know the first thing he looks for when he walks in the woods? He's looking for a good sword. You know what I'm saying? And he picks up that stick, and what's he say? Dad, pick one up. Let's see it. Let's go. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's something about wanting to move forward. There's something about having that sword in your hand. The Lord gives us a gift of his word. Are we in his word? Do you know his weapon? Do you know his sword? Do you know him? He's leading us to him. He's giving us confidence. He's giving us encouragement. He's giving us a blessing. He's giving us a challenge. He's calling us to a pursuit of him. And it all finds its fulfillment in prayer, calling and crying out to the Lord, praying to him and saying, Lord Jesus, I cannot do this on my own. I am weak. I am feeble. I am fickle. I need you. Because what I do know is the attacks of the enemy are real, and they can be devastating, harmful. And there are some of us who are here this morning, and we're hurting, we're suffering. And the Lord Jesus is calling to you, follow me, know my deliverance, know my strength, know that he wants to be with us and use us for the furtherance of his gospel. Highview, we cannot move forward. We cannot engage in the war on our own. It's only under the power and the strength of the Lord Jesus. He's calling us to himself. And I'm telling you, I know you're wrestling with one of these six. Guys, place one of those six back up there. I know you're wrestling with one of these. I know you are. It may be in powerless Christianity. You may not even know the Lord Jesus, and it's time to surrender. It may be in your family right now. It may be in hidden sin right now. It may be in a division in the church right now. God may be, you're wrestling with something, and God wants to deliver you this morning. The question is, will you let him? Will you surrender to him? Will you follow Jesus? The victor is standing before you, inviting you into his victory. Will you commit your way to him? Will you trust him? And will you let him act? Pray with me this morning. Lord Jesus, we come to you. And Lord, we humbly bow before you, knowing, Lord Jesus, you are calling us into a relationship. And Lord Jesus, you have presented us with everything we need to thrive in this relationship. You are our truth. You are our righteousness and our peace and our faith and our sword of the Spirit. You are our salvation. You are everything. And Lord Jesus, you're calling us into relationship. With all heads bowed and all eyes closed, you may not know the Lord Jesus this morning. It's time for you to surrender to him. He's calling you to surrender your life to him right now, in this moment. All you have to do is ask him. Believe upon him. And the scripture says you will be saved. There's some of you who are here this morning and you have made a profession in Christ, but man, you are wrestling right now. You are wrestling. The enemy has gained a foothold in your life, and now it's the moment where you allow the Lord to free you right now. Lord Jesus, give us the strength this morning and the courage this morning to believe and respond. And we pray for this in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to ask for you to stand where you are this morning. This is a response. God has spoken. Your heavenly Father has spoken. Will you respond to him? Will you become that mighty warrior for the gospel? Will you believe in the call that he's placed upon your life this morning? It's going to take courage to step out. It's going to take courage to come up here and do what? Pray. Cry out to the Lord. Pray this morning. Pray for your church. Pray for your family. Pray that the Lord, the warrior himself, frees us this morning. Come now.